وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله وصفوته من خلقه وحبيبه، قد بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وكشف الغمة وجاهد في سبيل دينه حتى أتاه اليقين. فاللهم اجزه عنا وعن والدينا وعن الإسلام والمسلمين خير ما جازيت به نبيًا عن قومه ورسولًا عن أمته. اللهم أحينا على سنته وأمتنا على ملته، واحشرنا تحت لوائه وأوردنا حوضه، واسقنا من يده الشريفة شربة هنيئة لا نظمأ بعدها أبدا. اللهم أمين. الله سبحانه وتعالى tells us in the Quran that he has made a promise. وعد الله الذين آمنوا منكم وعملوا الصالحات ليستخلفنهم في الأرض كما استخلف الذين من قبلهم. Allah سبحانه وتعالى has promised that those among you who would believe and do righteous deeds, they will be empowered in the land as others have been empowered before them. Allah سبحانه وتعالى promised the believers that he will give them victory in this life and on the day the witnesses are going to be resurrected. Last week, we spoke about the miseries that our Ummah has been living under for centuries. Today, we want to look at a perspective into our history as Muslims to see how the future may shape itself. Because only through our study of the past that we could have a view into the future. And this is one of the pieces of wisdom that we learn from the Quran. قُلْ سِيرُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ فَانْظُرُوا كَيْفَ كَانَ عَاقِبَةُ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ. Roam the earth and walk on the land and see what was the fate of those who came before you. If you look back to our history, which starts with Adam and then Noah and then Prophet Ibrahim, so on and so forth, until it comes to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you will find that it's always against what we think as humans that things go in the right direction. I will repeat this again. Things go in the opposite direction of what we think it should to go in the right direction. And the Quran always tells us there is a way for Allah to do things that are not subject to our own ways. Look, for example, Prophet Yusuf's story. A young boy was taken, thrown into the well, presumably to be dead, right? To starve and die. But Allah sends a caravan that picks him up to take care of him. He is put in the palace, albeit as a slave or potential servant, but also potential adopted child. And then he is tested in that palace. But Allah keeps telling us, وَكَذَلِكَ مَكَّنَّا لِيُوسُفَ فِي الْأَرْضِ. This is the way that he is empowered. He has to go through certain things that are counterintuitive to our limited minds, because things are run by Allah. Allah does what he does based on his knowledge and wisdom, not based on our knowledge or our wisdom. And the way he does what he does is not subject to our measurements. حتى يقول الرسول والذين آمنوا معه متى نصر الله. Until the messenger and those who believed with him say, when is the support of Allah coming? When is the victory that we have been promised? Well, it's not up to you. Even the messenger, it's not up to you. Allah tells him clearly, ليس لك من الأمر شيء أو يتوب عليهم أو يعذبهم فإنهم ظالمون. It's not up to you. When he wanted to get his uncle to accept Islam, and he put all his efforts till the last minute, telling him, my uncle, just say it, say La ilaha illallah. I will use it to argue before Allah on your behalf. Just say it. He says, no. And Allah tells him, إِنَّكَ لَا تَهْدِي مَنْ أَحْبَبْتَ. You do not guide whom you love. It's not up to you. وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ يَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ. So no matter how much trouble and evil and corruption and defeats and broken hearts and broken homes and broken nations you look and see around you, trust Allah if you are a believer that He will deliver you. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Al Imran, وَلَا تَهِنُوا وَلَا تَحْزَنُوا وَأَنْتُمُ الْأَعْلَوْنَ إِن كُنْتُم مُؤْمِنِينَ. Do not weaken. Do not be sad. And you are going to have the upper hand and the final say. The last laugh will be yours. So don't let the current or previous defeats shape your destiny or shape your future or undermine your optimism or trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah promised and His promise will be delivered. He never reneged on any of His promises. وَمَنْ أَصْدَقُ مِنَ اللَّهِ حَدِيثًا وَمَنْ أَصْدَقُ مِنَ اللَّهِ قِيلًا. So as much as you see what is going on, keep reading the Quran. It will show you what you don't want to see with your own eyes. If you open your heart, Allah will show you the way forward. The way forward is to believe and do what you have to do. Very simple, very straightforward. Do what you have to do, which means practice your faith. But before you practice, you must learn your faith. And before you learn your faith, you must have the will and the determination and the resolve that once you believe, you sign on the commitment to your faith. Which means, as we mentioned before, when Mus'ab ibn Umair came to accept Islam and the Prophet saw him very wealthy, very lavish person, he told him, إِذَنْ يُرَاقُ دَمُكْ وَيُعْقَرُ فَرَسُكْ وَيَضِيعُ مَالُكْ. You will lose everything you're enjoying now. Are you ready? And Mus'ab understood that this is a challenge, not a deterrent. So he accepted Islam, he accepted the challenge, and he fulfilled until the last minute his commitment to Allah and to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is the kind of faith that we need. We have a lot of people who are Muslims. They accept Islam, but they don't know what they are getting into. They want Islam without challenges. They want Islam when Islam is on the top of the world. They want Islam when it is easy. They want Islam without cost, without money, without sacrifice, without injury, without bloodshed, without anything. And there is no free lunch. This life teaches us that there is no free lunch. Only if you are invited. But we are not here invited to a free lunch. Allah tells us, فَاذْكُرُونِي أَذْكُرْكُمْ. Remember me, I remember you. And in the opposite, He also tells us, وَلَا تَكُونُ كَالَّذِينَ نَسُوا اللَّهَ فَأَنْسَاهُمْ أَنْفُسَهُمْ. نَسُوا اللَّهَ فَنَسِيَهُمْ. They ignored Allah, Allah ignored them. Nisyan here doesn't mean forgetfulness. It is ignoring Allah. We hear the adhan. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling us to kindness, to righteousness, to compassion, to be good to each other and to anybody else. And we are not meeting Allah where He wants us to be. So how would He deliver? Whom will He deliver to? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Hajj, الَّذِينَ إِن مَكَّنَّاهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ أَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةِ وَآتَوُوا الزَّكَاةِ وَأَمَرُوا بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَنَهَوْا عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ وَلِلَّهِ عَاقِبَةُ الْأُمُورِ. Those that when and if we empower them in the land, they will enjoin the good and denounce and forbid what is wrong and what's evil. And they will submit to Allah whatever the consequences may be. Do we do that? Why would Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala empower a community that does not do what they need to do, even without it being pushed, even without being cornered? What about our ummah is now cornered in a very bad spot? When do we respond to Allah if not now? Why are we waiting for the next generation to do what we don't want to do? They are not going to do anything different. We have to lead by example. We have to show our children that speaking truth has a price, and we as Muslims are willing to pay the price. We as Muslims understand that if you enjoin the good and forbid the evil, you will make friends into enemies. But you will only win good friends who are worthy of your friendship and brotherhood when you only enjoin the good and forbid the evil. لَتَأْمُرُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَلَتَنْهَوُنَّ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ وَلَتَأْخُذُنَّ عَلَى يَدِ الظَّالِمِ أَخْذًا وَلَتَأْطُرُنَّهُ عَلَى الْحَقِّ أَطْرًا وَلَتُقْصِرُنَّهُ عَلَى الْحَقِّ قَصْرًا أَوْ لَيَضْرِبَنَّ اللَّهُ قُلُوبَكُمْ بِقُلُوبِ بَعْضٍ وَيَلْعَنَكُمْ كَمَا لَعَنَهُمْ. This is the hadith of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Unless you enjoin the good and forbid the evil, Allah will confuse your hearts with one another, and He will curse you and doom you as He doomed those before you who did not enjoin the good and forbid the evil. This is the sign of our healthy sign for our ummah, that we enjoin the good and forbid the evil. If we let the evil take over, we lose the right to complain about corruption or nepotism or dhulm, wrongdoing, injustice. We lose all of these rights. Only when we stand for what is right, we never lose the right to fight back against corruption, against killing, against occupation, against injustices. But when we do not stand up, who is going to do it? Allah tells us, كُنْتُمْ خَيْرَ أُمَّةٍ أُخْرِجَتْ لِلنَّاسِ. You have been the best of nations that have been sent out for people, for mankind. Why? To enjoin the good and forbid the evil. This is the backbone of the health of our ummah. Our health is hinged on these two issues. We are the forces for good wherever we may be. In the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, الْمُؤْمِنُ كَالْغَيْثِ أَيْنَمَا وَقَعَ نَفَعَ. The believer is like a good rain. Wherever it falls, it produces something good. Why is it that even where we have our nation, in the many countries that we have, there is a lot of evil? Because we have left Islam behind us. We have deserted the Quran. And the Prophet ﷺ, he says, لَتَأْمُرُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَلَتَنْهَوُنَّ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ أَوْ لَيُسَلِّطَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكُمْ عَدُوًّا لَا يَرْحَمُكُمْ حَتَّى تَرْجِعُوا إِلَى دِينِكُمْ. Unless you enjoin the good and forbid the evil, Allah will send a very bad enemy against you, and this situation will not change until you go back to Allah. We have to go back. So the question is not, when is victory coming? The questions should be, are we the believers that Allah promised? Are we up to the task? Are we doing what it takes to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to change the conditions of our ummah? Our ummah needs a community that stands up unwavering when it comes to truth and justice. فَبِالْحَقِّ أَنْزَلْنَاهُ وَبِالْحَقِّ نَزَلْ. It is in truth that we've sent it down, the Quran, and it is in truth that it has come down, which means it will be executed. This is the will of Allah. whether it is our generation or someone else's generation. But definitely it's not going to be the next generation if we do not prepare the groundwork. Let me then take you back to a little bit of history to see how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He wills something to happen, He lays the groundwork for it centuries and millennia before it comes. He lays the groundwork. Look, for example, we give the example of Prophet Yusuf and how he evolved from a child without father, without mother, picked in the desert in a well, into the king or the prime minister. How he was empowered. No power of his own, except the power of his faith. He never wavered on his faith. Look at the Arabian Peninsula well before Islam. From the time of Ibrahim, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that Ibrahim settled his family in an arid desert place. رب إني أسكنت من ذريتي بواد غير ذي زرع عند بيتك المحرم. I want you to pay attention to this. So Ibrahim settles his family in a non-cultivated valley, arid desert. Not even water is there. In obedience and submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then he goes back to Palestine and he comes back in a few years, and together with his son Ismail, he elevates or raises up the foundation of the Kaaba, as we know the story. So the deen of Ibrahim was not settled in the green land of Palestine, or even the watery green land of Egypt, as he went to Egypt. It grew up in the desert. Why is the desert? And from there forward, until the time of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the desert of Arabia continued to be the desert of Arabia. Arid, rough land, none or very few plants here and there. People struggled, walked miles to get a paddle of water to drink or to wash or to grow anything. It's a struggle life. Why would Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala get this deen in particular in the desert? Imagine the opposite. The desert of Arabia is no desert. It's a green land, running rivers, all fruits, all vegetables, wealthy land. Right? Would the empires around this desert not attacked Arabia and decimated that religion from the beginning? They would. Even though it was a desert, from the north of Arabia, from Sham and Syria, the Roman Empire threatened the fledgling community in Medina to come down a month's travel to come down to obliterate the Muslim community when it's very fledgling few members in the community. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala supported the Muslims. Hence came the battle of Mu'tah, the battle of Tabuk. And we know the history on this. So imagine if Arabia had oil and engines were as it is today. Today, all the world is clamping down on Muslims, right? Because of resources or the potential that Muslims may stand up and defend their positions and their rights. It is on us Muslims to defend our deen and to defend our land and to defend our communities and families and to defend the underprivileged and the exploited and the weak and the meek and the broken and the occupied, whether they are Muslims or not. This is the stance of Islam. But from history, the desert grows up people who are rough and tough. Khalid ibn al-Walid, in his history, he was sent to learn horsemanship and fighting when he was 7 years old. By the age of 9, he was a fighter. Khalid ibn al-Walid learned in the Bedouin side of the desert, which means not the green areas of the desert, but outside. He has to fight for survival, even as a child. But he grew up to be a man unlike no other. He has no parallel in history. Khalid ibn al-Walid is the one who invented the ambush in the military tactic. He invented the round circles in military tactics that you don't have to attack your enemy from the front. You can just circle around from both sides. And that's what he did in the Battle of Uhud. He invented those tactics that are being taught and practiced until today in all militaries. Of course, airplane and fighter jets now, they change the whole drama of war, but still those tactics are still ground tactics that no army could do without. No matter how much you have of tanks, the Battle of 1973, it was a battle between Egypt and Syria and Jordan on one side and Israel on the other. This tactic was used, circling the enemy from the sides and from behind. So Khalid ibn al-Walid is a symbol for our ummah in terms of courage, bravery, military tactics, manliness. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent him a very simple message. From the days of Uhud and before, he kept fighting the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Even on the day of Hudaybiyah, it was Khalid ibn al-Walid standing against the Muslims getting into Mecca for Umrah. But then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent him a message telling him, Khalid, inna lanara anna laka larajahata aqlin narju alla tuaddi bika illa ila al-Islam. Khalid, we see that you are too wise to end up anywhere but in Islam. Khalid reads the message and he goes right there to the Prophet ﷺ to submit and surrender and become a Muslim. And he becomes Sayfullah al-Maslul, the drawn sword of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Khalid grew up in the desert, and the desert is what protects Islam. If Muslims were becoming the top in technology, the top in everything, the top of this, they would have been finished very early. Is it good not to have to be in the top? No, it is not. But Allah works His ways, not our ways. All what we need to do is climb the ladder of hard work. Climb the ladder for justice and for truth. Climb the ladder for morality and ethics. Lead by example, and Allah will empower us. You look at the life of the Prophet ﷺ. Never lied once. Not once. Well before becoming a prophet. Look at that level of self-discipline and self-control. He never reneged on a promise. He never took back his word. He spent a life of magnanimity and generosity and giving, even when he didn't have what to give. He would borrow from people to pay those who are asking him. It's like extending your own personal credit to someone else, giving someone your credit card, put it on me, and he would give and keep giving. He was never afraid to give. He was never afraid to stand. But the Arabs who grew up in the desert, they had manners that were not very different from the manners of the Prophet ﷺ, who grew up in the same environment. they would stand for justice for each other. There used to be something called al-jawar, which means to extend protection to someone who is vulnerable and weak. So the Prophet ﷺ went to al-Ta'if, and he was not met with good reception, and he was kicked out. He came back. On his way back to Mecca, he requested one of the Arab leaders, Al-Mut'am ibn Adi, to extend his protection to the Prophet ﷺ. Al-Mut'am never accepted Islam, but he was a man of ethics. This is what is Bedouin, to be a man of your word. And if you have the means, you don't just act selfishly. It's not only yours. You have the power, you protect the powerless. You have the sultan, you extend your sultan to help the helpless. This is the manners of the Arabs. And they were worthy of sending the Prophet in their midst. The Prophet didn't come in Arabia by chance. Allah laid down the groundwork to bring the Prophet in the middle of this atmosphere, this environment, because they were worthy of receiving the message. Allah prepared them. So Al-Mut'am goes to his tribe, which were all full of horsemen and fighters, and he tells them, I am allowing Muhammad to enter into my protection. And people were shocked. You don't believe in him? He said, yes, but he is weak. I am powerful. I have to stand up. Amazing. For these types of manners and attitudes, Allah chose Arabia to be the housing and the ground and the place where the Prophet ﷺ grows up and where he is commissioned to be a Prophet ﷺ. So he takes Prophet Muhammad all the way into the Kaaba and he tells him, Muhammad, salli ma shi'at. And he told the Quraysh, Muhammad is in my protection. Nobody should come near him. Nobody should talk even against him. Nobody should attack him. For these types of people, Arabia and the Arabian Peninsula became the cradle of Islam at the time of the Prophet ﷺ. Now, we need to look at our situation today. Do we have manners like those pre-Islamic Arabs? Do we have the protection? Do we have the magnanimity, the courage, the standing? Do we have the love for truth and justice? Do we love the poor and the underprivileged and the weak? Do we like to stand? Until we stand for them, Allah will not stand for us. Because he says, الَّذِينَ إِن مَكَّنَّاهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ أَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةِ وَآتَوُ الزَّكَاةِ. Those that if we empower in the land, they will establish prayer, which is a symbol for establishing the whole deen, not just the salah. وَآتَوُ الزَّكَاةِ. And they provide the zakah. They know and believe that others have right in their own wealth. وَأَمَرُوا بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَنَهَوْا عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. Unfortunately, when we try to compare our situation as Muslims who grew up as Muslims, or even those who accepted Islam as adults, we find that our level of commitment cannot be even compared to the level of decency and manners and ethics of the pre-Islamic Arabia. It doesn't mean that Arabs before Islam were pure angelic. They had their own dark sides as well. But at least that side, the good side, prepared them to receive the message, to stand for Allah, and to be worthy of receiving the message and becoming the best generation, according to the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, خير القرون قرني ثم الذين يلونهم ثم الذين يلونهم ثم الذين يلونهم. The best of generation is my generation. then the following generation, then the following generation, then the following generation. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us similar to those great generations, to open our heart to love Allah and to love al-Islam and to love the Quran and to practice what we believe and to let Islam shine and radiate goodness and compassion and love to humanity as a whole. Allahumma ameen. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وبعد. Brothers and sisters, whenever we talk about our mission as Muslims in reforming the world, we always have to start with reforming ourselves. And when we start talking about reforming ourselves, we always look for a scapegoat to take excuses and shelter behind them. We always love to talk about, you know, ruthless rulers and unjust governors and all of this. But listen, Allah does not wrong anybody. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَظْلِمُ النَّاسَ شَيْئًا. Allah will not allow a despot to rule over a group of righteous people. We have to deliver before we ask Allah to deliver. We have to deliver on our promises. When we committed and said, La ilaha illallah, unless we deliver on this commitment, why should we ask Allah to deliver on His promise? So His promise is right in around the corner for us. It is in the reach of our hand. Allah says, Ala inna nasr Allahi Qareeb. Qareeb in the Arabic language means it is near. It is in your reach. Just extend your hand, you'll have it. We need to wake up. We need to remember that when we say Allahu Akbar, we should mean it. When we say Alhamdulillah, we should mean it. We should never equivocate when it comes to praising Allah. Some of us say, Alhamdulillah, but. There is no but. Alhamdulillah means, I am satisfied. Whatever Allah gives me, whatever Allah takes away from me, I am satisfied. I am grateful to Allah for whatever He gives, for whatever He takes, because when He gives, it's a test, even if I don't recognize it. And when He takes away, it's also a test. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the best of ways and give us the love of Allah and the love of Islam. Allahumma habib ilayna al-iman wa zayyinhu fi qulubina wa karrih ilayna al-kufra wal-fusuq wal-asyan waj'alna min al-rashidina fadlan minka wa ni'ma. Allahumma ahdina fi man hadayt wa afina fi man afayt wa tawallana fi man tawallayt wa qina wasrif anna sharra ma qadayt. اللهم اقسم لنا من خشيتك ما تحول به بيننا وبين معصيتك ومن طاعتك ما تبلغنا به جنتك ومن اليقين ما تهون به علينا مصائب الدنيا ومتعنا اللهم بأسماعنا وأبصارنا وقوتنا ما أحييتنا واجعله الوارث منا واجعل ثأرنا على من ظلمنا ولا تجعل مصيبتنا في ديننا ولا تجعل الدنيا أكبر همنا ولا مبلغ علمنا ولا إلى النار مصيرنا. اللهم اشف مرضانا ومرضى المسلمين وارحم موتانا وموتى المسلمين وانصر عبادك المجاهدين في كل مكان. اللهم عليك بالظلمة والطغاة والجبارين والمعتدين فإنهم لا يعجزونك. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم فستذكرون ما أقول لكم وأفوض أمري إلى الله. إن الله بصير بالعباد وأقم الصلاة.
الله أكبر الله أكبر.